a brand new series called Fierce Faith. This is part two, and now it's actually up on the screen. If you have your app, you can follow along in the fill-in-the-blank notes. And how many of you guys realize that God wants us to be faithful? I think it's easy to think, well, God is faithful. We always attribute this characteristic to God. God is faithful, and we've been talking about faith. We've been talking about putting it into action to see a difference. We all love that part, don't we? We love the change. I want to use my faith to make a difference. I want to use my faith to believe God for some blessings, to believe for some fruitfulness in my life. But faithfulness precedes fruitfulness. You're not going to have the fruit unless you're faithful. What is being faithful? Faithful is the daily decision to keep following God no matter what it costs. I don't think you get to the fruit of your faith unless you're faithful. We all like fruit, right? How many of you like fruit? Anybody ever use one of those fruit of the month subscriptions? You get a box of fruit. Yeah, I haven't either. I've heard about them. It may be an antiquated idea. We all love fruit. Send me some fruit. Bring me some fruit. Lord, I want to see the fruit in my life. But we forget the fact that fruitfulness comes after faithfulness. We've got to be faithful. I don't think it's something talked about enough. It's definitely downplayed in our culture. You see, we love the highlight reels, the mountaintop experiences, right? We love living at the top of the mountain. But how many of you know that the top of the mountain was never designed to be lived at? You get to the top of the mountain by faithfully taking one step at a time, climbing your way up the side. We're all going to have some mountaintop experiences. I thank God for those. But those are moments in time. Faithfulness is everything we do in between. I want to talk to you today about the idea of faithfulness. Proverbs 20, verse 6 says, many claim to have unfailing love, but a faithful person, who can find? In other words, talk is cheap. Many claim to be full of faith. Many say, I'm a believer, I'm a follower, but a faithful person, who can find? Hey, let your actions do the talking. You might have heard it said, if you're great at something, you don't need to tell anybody. Others will say it about you. I love when somebody just tells me that they're the most humble person they've ever met and how they love God just so ridiculously and they're just doing amazing at this thing called faith and they're so faithful. It's like, yeah, really? Talk is cheap. Let your actions do the talking. Let's not be people of hype on the weekend. Hey, listen, I'm all about passion. I love passion. This is a passionate church. We want to have a passionate response to what Jesus has done in and through us. Man, I want worship to be passionate. I love throwing my hands up, jumping around, experiencing the presence of God. But passion without faithfulness is fleeting. We can talk about passion. We can talk about talents and gifts. Those are good things. But they don't last without faithfulness. If God finds you faithful, you will be fruitful. Somebody turn to your neighbor and say, you will be fruitful. You will be fruitful. I thank God I'm talking to a faithful group of people. You will be fruitful. You will see the fruit in your life as a result of the faithfulness in your life. We live in a generation that's about plastic and it's postured and it's about presenting an image, right? Where my Insta followers at? Yeah, you know. It's like, well, this is my 17th selfie, but I want to change the lighting, and I need to do a little filter, and it's got to be perfect, and we put this image out there, and we want things quick, we want things now, we want things to look good, but how many of you know that God is more interested in what's going on the inside? 1 Samuel 16, it says, Lord does not look at the things people look at. People look at the outward appearance, but the Lord looks at the heart. Aren't you grateful that God doesn't judge us on the outward appearance, that he's not like this culture, this world, which is about disposable relationships and putting out a front and just making sure things look good? No, he's faithful forever. He's always there. He's more concerned about what is going on the inside of you and I. I wonder what images come to your mind when I say the word faithful. We all think of Old Faithful, right? The geyser, water spitting up, that's one image. Maybe a faithful car. Like maybe, I don't know what your image of a faithful car, a Toyota Corolla, that's faithful. Like, that'll get you. It's not fancy, but it's going to get you to point A to point B, right? And not a lot on gas. I don't know if you think about a faithful old truck. I don't know if you think about a dog. Dogs are faithful, right? We don't like to think of ourselves as an old dog, but some of us are. If you've worked in a company for 35, 40 years, they would say you're faithful. And at the end of that, they would award you with a watch for your faithfulness. It's awesome. In the kingdom of God, it's not the same. Faithfulness is what God looks for the most. Did you know that God preserves the very best part of life for those who are faithful? We can't just talk about a fierce faith and a faith to believe for change and stand on God's word and see this community change. We can't talk about all that without talking about the necessity of faithfulness. God celebrates faithfulness. I believe God desires faithfulness. Psalm 12:1 says, "Help, Lord, for no one is faithful anymore. Those who are loyal have vanished from the human race." This is the author of Psalms just lamenting. There doesn't seem to be anybody else faithful. You look around at our culture, it's an underrated term. It's not something that is promoted in American cultural Christianity. Faithfulness is underrated, but in the kingdom of God, it is what God is looking for the most. Proverbs 28:20 says, "A faithful person will be richly blessed, but one eager to get rich will not go unpunished." In other words, when you're just living for the now, when you're just trying to get your blessings and all your rewards now, it's worthless. It'll leave you wanting. It'll leave you lacking. But a faithful person will be richly blessed. Our living for today is actually the opposite of faithful. And our culture promotes this idea, don't they? Live for today. FOMO. Fear of missing out. YOLO. You only live once. How many other stupid acronyms and sayings are there? No, you don't only live once. You live for eternity, and what we do here in this life matters. What we invest into today affects our future, not only in heaven someday, but on this earth, in this life. This is a kingdom concept, not a cultural one. This is something we need to be trained. This is something we need to be taught in, and I believe that when we get faithful on the inside of us, it'll change your world. You will start to see the fruit that you desire, not overnight, but over a process of time. Faithfulness is taking that next step, is staying the course, is remaining obedient, is staying on track. 1 Corinthians 1:9 says, "God will do this, for he is faithful to do what he says. And he has invited you into partnership with his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord." God is faithful. We all know that. But he invites us into partnership. That's us being faithful back. My wife, Tara, is not here today. She's a bridal hairstylist. She's doing some hairdos for a wedding. And we'll be married almost 11 years in a couple of months. And thank you. That's an accomplishment. I'll take it. And when I say goodbye to her in the morning, hey, have a great wedding. I hope everything goes well. I pray there's no bridezillas. Like, real. And, you know, I never have to say, "Hey, Tara, can you not cheat on me today?" Like, I don't have to remind her to be faithful. I don't know if you know, if I had to remind Tara to be faithful all the time, we probably never would have gotten married. Why? Because faithfulness is not something that she is learning how to become. Faithfulness is part of who she is. Faithfulness is part of her character. She said some vows almost 11 years ago. I believe her, and I trust her, and she's walking it out. And the result, the fruit of her faithfulness, is she gets a fine husband to come home to every day. Why are you laughing at that? That's... Man, and on the same note, I don't get reminded by Tara, "Hey, be faithful." Faithfulness is part of who we are. And when we get this down the inside of us, it becomes part of our heart posture, our attitude. We walk out a life of faithfulness, not perfection. We're all going to stumble in our faith journey, right? It's not about never sinning again or never missing the mark. We know that we all do, we all will. In our faith journey, and God's grace is there to forgive us, to pick us up, and to spur us on again to continue the walk of faithfulness. I have four thoughts for you, if you're taking notes, about faithfulness. And I've entitled today's message, A Faith That Stays. A Faith That Stays. Number one, a faith that stays is a faith that surrenders. A faith that surrenders. Surrendering to God is not throwing your hands up and going, all right, God, you do it all. I'm not going to do anything. I surrender. You do it. That's a misinterpretation of the word surrender. Surrendering is actually saying, I'm letting go of my will and my agenda, and I'm going to keep my hands busy, staying faithful, doing the thing that you've called me to do. Many of us say, man, I haven't heard from God in a while. I don't know what he wants me to do. Are you doing the thing he told you to do last? Are you staying faithful with the last step he gave you? You know, Jesus likened the kingdom of God as a house, and he said, the wise servant, the faithful servant, is the one who is still looking after the house, still looking after the servants when the master returns home. Are you still doing the business of God, what he called us to do, his work, his ministry? Are you faithful in the last thing that he said? A faith that stays is a faith that surrenders. It's about saying no to your flesh, about saying, I'm not just going to get tossed to and fro by every wind of doctrine. I'm not just going to, man, I don't feel like it anymore. I think it's better if I do this. And I haven't seen God move. I haven't heard. So I'm just going to change directions. I'm going to pivot, and I'm going to do what I think. No, you say, I'm going to remain faithful. I'm going to stay the course in what God called me to do. Where you are right now is where God called you to be. He has ordained every one of your steps, the Bible says. Will you stay faithful in what God has called you to do? Luke 9:62, Jesus replied, no one puts his hand to the plow and looks back is fit for service in the kingdom of God. That's harsh words. Jesus said it, I didn't, so I'm just communicating what Jesus said. No one who puts a hand to the plow and looks back is fit for service in the kingdom of God. In other words, he's saying, don't commit to something unless you're willing to see it through. Be a person of integrity. Let your yes be yes and your no be no. Don't just say, yeah, I'm going to sign up for that and then no show. How about signing up for an all-star team and saying, I have some availability and yeah, put me on the roster twice a month and then actually showing up. I know that for some of you, you're like, that's kind of harsh, Josh. You'd be surprised how many times we have people that just no-show church. And I think there's a mentality that's creeped into church and it's a, oh, well, I'm just a volunteer. They should be grateful that I'm helping out at all. No, you're not just a volunteer. We don't even like that word around here. We use the term all-star because it's better to be in the house of God serving as a gatekeeper than in the tents of the wicked, the Bible says. And it's a privilege and a joy we have to build the house of God, to serve the King of Kings, to love on some people. This is not just a volunteer position like you might be donating some of your free time to a hospital or to a charity. This is the kingdom of God. This is the house of God. And Jesus said, I will build my church and the gates of hell will not prevail against it. He loved the church so much, he died for it. This is a privilege. We need to change our perspective. We need to get some faithfulness on the inside of us. This isn't a manipulation tactic. Don't hear this as condemning. The word of God is full of grace. He wants to pick you up wherever you find yourself this morning. He wants to encourage you. He wants you to develop some fierce faith on the inside. And I believe that looks like faithfulness. I think of a story in 1 Kings 19, and this scripture won't go up on the screen, but you might have heard this story. There's a guy named Elisha, and he had a successful business. Many oxen in the field, many workers working for him. Things seemed to be going great. And then another prophet named Elijah comes along, and he gives him an opportunity to change directions, to live a God life, the adventure of faith, following the man of God, learning, and ultimately would get double the anointing. And he had to choose in that moment. Am I going to stay here where things are good? Am I going to stay here where things seem to be going well? There's blessing, there's some prosperity, there's some success, things are growing. Or am I going to change directions and follow God where there's uncertainty, there's risk, I don't know what the outcome's going to be? And he chose the right decision. He chose to follow God. And I love that the Bible says he doesn't just choose and follow Elijah. He actually takes the plows and he sets them on fire. He has a big bonfire and then he kills the oxen and uses the bonfire to cook them up as a sacrifice. In other words, he says, I'm not going back. Once he made his decision, he says, I'm going to carry this thing. I'm going to see this thing through. I'm going to be faithful to the calling God has put on my life. And he burned his backup plan. I don't know if you have something in your life maybe God is calling you to burn. Maybe he's saying you need to cut the ropes, end the relationship, close the door on that chapter. Why? Because if you have a backup plan, oftentimes you'll go back. If you have something to fall back on, we tend to fall back, don't we? God sometimes is calling us to burn the oxen, to burn the plow, to not look back and press on into the life of faith and adventure and uncertainty and see it through to the end. What is God calling you to burn the plows in? What is he calling you to let go of? You know what I'm convinced? The longer I follow Jesus, the more I do this thing called the faith journey, the more I realize that the closer you get to Jesus, the more difficult to ask. Think about this. He's got a group of 12 guys. First thing he says to them, hey, where do you live? Jesus is like, come and see. Come check it out. Hey, we're a come and see kind of church. We want people to come check it out. Invite your friends. Like, this is not a place where you can be scared. You know the sayings, oh, I couldn't walk into a church. The ceiling would come falling down if I walked in. No. That's not how church works. The church is not a museum for saints. It's a hospital for sinners. Come one, come all who are weary, come and see. Come and see. But then Jesus spends time investing into these guys month after month, year after year, and he's pouring out everything he wants them to know and to learn. And eventually he says, take up your cross. Which in that term, they would have understood that's not a little gold chain around the neck type situation. That's a, you're going to die for me. The closer you get to Jesus, the more difficult to ask. And it was getting to the end of Jesus' ministry, and things were starting to heat up. He was talking about that he was going to die. People were trying to kill him constantly. The persecution was real. And some of the followers started scattering. And in John 6, 68, Jesus asked him, are you going to leave too? And Peter answered him, Lord, to whom shall we go? You have the words of eternal life. In other words, he said, we're going to be faithful. We're going to stay the course. We're going to stay connected to you. We're going to stay serving you. We're going to remain faithful. Fierce faith says, I'm not going to do what's only convenience. I'm going to surrender my will, my objective, my agenda. I'm going to be committed to what I committed to and follow through. Of course, we know the story that Peter ultimately denied Jesus three times. And God, in his grace and mercy, was still faithful to Peter. And he restores him and he says, do you love me? And Peter's like, of course you know I love you, Lord. He's like, okay, then feed my sheep. In other words, take care of people. He asks him again, do you love me? Yes, yes, Jesus, I love you. Look after my sheep. Do you love me? And at this time, I can just imagine tears falling down his face. And Jesus, you know I love you. He says, feed my sheep. Taking care of people, looking after others when it's not convenient. That's a mature faith. That's a fierce faith. Being in it, not just for yourself, being in it for God's sheep, other people. A faith that stays is a faith that surrenders. Number two, a faith that stays is a faith that serves when it's difficult. A faith that serves when it's difficult. You know that not every Sunday here at the Station Church is like easy breezy. Everything goes according to plan. It's just full of peace. Before service, we have a 45-minute sort of prayer meeting and just a little kumbaya and like worship. And you know, it's not always like that. Sometimes the enemy is on full front attack and he's trying to stop what it is God wants to do. Especially being a church plant and setting up and tearing down. Every week, you know, there's the sound system and the speakers and the projector and all of the rest. And sometimes there's complications. Sometimes it's just sound system. And sometimes I believe there's demons in the sound system in Jesus' name. We just have to kick them out and pray over them. But it's not always easy. Sometimes it's difficult. How about in your personal life? Maybe you're scheduled. You're committed to do something. And then, you know what inevitably always happens? Something difficult pops up. Something inconvenient. You get a flat tire on the way to church, or you don't get a better opportunity to do something on a Sunday. A festival pops up, a deal on some tickets. I don't know what it is. You get invited to the beach, and you have the decision. Am I going to be faithful? Am I going to stay the course, even when it's difficult? Now listen, I'm not saying there's not circumstances where things pop up and there's real life happens, right? But I'm trying to preach to some fierce faith on the inside of you so that we can develop some faithfulness so that we just say, come hell or high water, I'm going to be a person of my word. I'm going to be faithful to the thing God called me to do. I'm going to stay the course. I'm not going to be bouncing around and church shopping and giving up on my faith and then coming back and giving up. No, I'm just going to hold on to the anchor of my soul. Life is going to get topsy-turvy. The storms and the winds are going to blow. But Jesus, I'm holding on to you. I will follow you for the rest of my life. I'm going to have some fierce faith and be faithful. I don't know if I'm talking to anybody with some fierce faith this morning. Proverbs 25:19. Don't be like this. It says, like a bad tooth, or my dentist said, like a bad tooth or a lame foot is reliance on the unfaithful in times of trouble. I don't know if you want to be likened to a bad tooth or a lame foot. Anybody ever had a lame foot? I'm not exactly sure what that looks like, but it's probably nasty. I don't imagine it smelling too good. Don't be a lame foot. Don't be a bad tooth. That's relying on somebody that just, it just causes you pain, causes you disappointment. Why? Because they're just not faithful. They don't follow through. They don't commit. They don't do what it is they said they were going to do. We all know people like this in our lives. If you don't know anybody, it's probably you. So that's all right. You're here today, and you're learning how to be faithful. If you really want to know your measure, it's what you look like in the middle of a storm. When life squeezes you, what comes out? Is it joy, peace, trust? This is really hard right now, but I believe God has something greater. I believe he has a bigger plan. I'm going to hold on. Or when the circumstances get tough and the stress increases and everything seems to be going wrong, do you get angry and bitter and all sorts of garbage comes out of your mouth? You know that the measure of your life, what's really on the inside, is what comes out when life applies the pressure. Martin Luther King Jr. put it like this: the ultimate measure of a man is not where he stands in moments of comfort and convenience, but where he stands in times of challenge and controversy. You know, he wrote that from inside a Birmingham prison. Aren't you grateful that he had the right perspective, that he remained faithful to stand up for a good cause, even though things got difficult? And today we stand in the blessing of a movement that marched against injustice and against racism, and we still benefit the fruits of that faithfulness. I wonder what the future will look like, what fruits they will benefit from because of your faithfulness today. What we do now matters. Echoes in the halls of eternity. Sorry, Gladiator reference. What we do now makes a difference. Our faithfulness is not just about us. It's about what God wants to do through us, about what he wants to unfold in those around you as a result of your faithfulness. Listen, it's going to get difficult. Jesus promised us that. You're going to have some trials. You're going to have some problems. Don't give up. Remain faithful. Stay the course. You can do it, and you're not meant to do it on your own. That's why we have summer connect groups, man. We're going to be at the beach playing some spike ball and talking about Jesus. That's a good time, in my opinion, right there. Sign up for a connect group. Sign up for Babes on the Beach. Where the babes at? Which, side note, the guys, we're now calling ourselves the Station Studs. They got babes on the beach. Their babes were studs with a Z. This is misspelling out there on the card. It's important. Guys, if you don't feel like a stud, you don't feel like you're faithful, come to the connect group. We will help you get there. Number three, shameless plug. A faith that stays is a faith that multiplies what matters. Multiplies what matters. You know the parable of the talents. There's God entrusts to three guys a certain measure of talent, which wasn't a gifting in that culture. That was a certain amount of resource. And those who multiplied it were commended, enter into eternal blessing. And the one who just kind of held on to it, he thought he was keeping it safe. He thought he was doing the right thing. I'm just not going to take risks. I don't want to lose it. I know that the master is a harsh man. He had a wrong perspective, not just on life, but on God our Father. And for his keeping it to himself, just staying safe and not taking risk and not using his faith, it says he was cast out into outer darkness. You know, the highest title in the kingdom of God is servant. And the highest compliment of heaven for your life is faithful servant. Well done, good and faithful servant. When God sees you as a servant and you're faithful, that's the greatest affirmation we can receive from the King. It's not, that sounds nice. Maybe we'll kind of get to that someday. Like, no, this is our life's goal, to be faithful to the one who is so faithful towards us. Matthew 25:23, referencing the parable of the talents, the master said, "Well done, my good and faithful servant. You have been faithful in handling this small amount. So now I will give you many more responsibilities. Let's celebrate together." I always think that's funny because the reward for faithfulness in the kingdom of God is more responsibilities. In the kingdom of God, you do a good job, and the king says, "I'm going to give you some more to do." Like, don't we all have enough to do? But we have to change our perspective that it's a blessing, it's a privilege. The more we are faithful to God, the more he rewards us with more responsibility, with more opportunity to oversee his kingdom. I believe Jesus is building his staff. And someday we're all going to be in heaven, and they're going to be those who are on staff. They're going to be generals and commanders and rulers of the different things there are to do in the areas. And he's looking for those who are faithful now to build his staff in the kingdom of eternity. I don't know if that kind of strikes your heart chord and you're like, man, I want to be on Jesus' staff. I do. I don't want to be part of the people left out watching all the fun and just mowing my lawn. And I don't know what you do in heaven, but I want to be counted faithful when Jesus says, come on board, good and faithful servant. It's not about just holding on, gripping to what we have. It's about multiplying it, using what God has given you to increase. We should be pursuing increase in our lives in every area. Don't be lured into the lie of the enemy that there's just this comfortable Christianity, this apathetic kind of no worries, bro, just chill, coast through life. No. We should be believing for more. We should be asking for more. More influence, more resource, more faith, more understanding of God's grace, a better understanding of who we are in him. We need to grow and increase in our influence so that we can pour out and bless others. This is a fierce faith, multiplying what God has given us. And number four, the last thought, a faith that stays is a faith that is in it for others. The ultimate sign of a faithful, mature believer, when you're in it for the right reasons. You understand, hey, it's not about just what I can get out of it. I'm not just going to use my faith so that I get blessed, so that I receive more, so that I can have more. Look, if the blessings are your goal, you will be found wanting. They will not satisfy your soul. Let's never get more caught up and distracted by the gifts of God than we are by the gift giver. We need to be so in love with Jesus that he is our pursuit. His kingdom, his glory, his relationship. He's done so much for us that we just want to draw close to him, to serve him, to love him. And the more we do, the more he changes our heart and gets us to look outside of ourselves, understanding this life is not about us. This life is about being faithful so that we can serve others, so that we can make a difference. It's about having a selfless faith. 1 Timothy 1:12, Timothy says, "I thank Christ Jesus our Lord that he considered me faithful, putting me in the ministry." Now you might think, well, that's good for you, pastor. I'm not in the ministry. Hey, did you know that the servant isn't a pastor? It's not a bishop. I don't know what I am to you today. If this is your home, I'm your pastor. If you're just visiting, I'm just your preacher. But regardless, you're in ministry. The Bible says we are all called to the ministry of reconciliation. You have the Spirit of God living in you. You are anointed. Your days are ordained. You have every spiritual weapon and tool you need to succeed, to reach and to love and to serve those around you. You are in ministry. Can we have the perspective that's fierce faith, that's a faithful perspective, says, Lord, I just thank God that I have the opportunity to serve others. That's all ministry is loving other people, caring for other people. Lord, thank you that you put me in the position of ministry. Why? Because we don't deserve it. Who are we? Who am I? But God says, I see faithfulness on the inside of you. I see greatness on the inside of you. I see potential on the inside of you. God speaks to things that are not as though they are, calling out things into existence. And I wonder today if he's calling you into a greater level of faithfulness. If the measure of God's love is how good things work out for you, he must not have loved Paul at all. That guy saw some hard times. Are you familiar with his story? I mean, that guy was shipwrecked. He was beaten nearly to death on more than one occasion, thrown in prison, which is more like dungeon, more than one occasion. He is the guy who pioneered surfing. He's shipwrecked and he rides in a board onto the beach, only to be bitten by a snake. And he shakes it off and gave Taylor Swift some inspiration and then just kept on keeping on. Like, this guy had it rough, y'all. People are always trying to kill him, always trying to get after him. But Paul understood faithfulness in my life. It's not just for me. It's not because things are going well. It's not because things are convenient. No, faithfulness is about pushing through, especially when things get hard. Why? Because it's not just about here and now. It's not just about my life. We need to have an eternal perspective that says, God, I'm going to be faithful to the end because you are faithful towards me. I understand you have a bigger plan. I don't always understand it. Can we be honest? I don't necessarily see what the heck he's doing at times. Like, really? That doesn't make any sense. Will you be faithful anyways? Will you be faithful anyways? Philippians 2:20. Paul said, I have no one like Timothy who takes genuine interest in your welfare. For everyone looks out for his own interests and not those of Jesus Christ. But Timothy has proved himself. He has served with me in the work of the gospel. He said, man, there's something different about Timothy. He's faithful. Everybody else is looking out for their own interests. This guy looks out for the genuine interests in others. A faith that stays. It's a faith that isn't in it for just you. You're in it for others. Here's a little summer homework, if you will. Write down the names of three people that you can turn to in times of trouble. Who comes to mind? Maybe it's a parent, a best friend, a sibling. Then go one step further and ask the question, on whose list would I be written down? Who looks at me and says, that guy's faithful. I can depend on him. I can rely on her. If you can't think of very many people whose list you'd be on, then perhaps this is what God is speaking to you about. I believe that as Christians, we, more than all people, should be faithful. It's not just about a belief. It's not just about believing for me and standing on the promises for my blessings. No. Fierce faith says, I'm going to get to the blessings. I'm going to get to the promises by first being faithful. And not overnight, but over time, faithfulness produces fruitfulness. It's a radical type of faith. It's a faith that gets your eyes off of your own life, your own welfare even, and out onto the other people in your life that God has brought. Our culture says, what's in it for me? But I'm thankful that the people of God, the people of the Station Church, come on somebody, say, I've got some fierce faith. I'm going to be faithful so that I can ask God what could be through me. Not just what's in it for me, what could be through me. 2 Timothy 2:13 says, if we are unfaithful, he remains faithful. For he cannot deny who he is. In other words, it's just who God is. He doesn't have to work at being faithful. He just is faithful. And he wants to do a work in you and I so that that's just part of who we are. It becomes a natural byproduct. Let's pray. God, we thank you that you are so faithful to us. Despite our unfaithfulness, God, you are always there. You never leave us or forsake us. You are always ready and available to forgive and to pick us up when we fall and stumble. And Lord, I pray today that this would be an encouraging word, that we would all hear the voice of heaven, that you believe us to be faithful, that you want us to be people with character and integrity that stay the course. God, I recognize this looks different in everyone's life, and I pray that we would just hear from you and take the next step that you're calling each and every one of us to take. Lord, today we choose to continue to follow you. Even though things might be difficult, even though it might not be convenient, and perhaps we have what we think is a better idea and we're thinking about changing courses, Lord, we remain faithful. We choose to